in this special edition of Impact. We meet a family using an alternative method to communicate with their young disabled son.
It gives us access to him and his personality and his thoughts and his ideas and his humor and his interests, things he doesn't like. It's a lifeline in a sense, because all that he has to do is make contact with the screen. That's it.
Welcome to Impact. I'm Raquel Estupinan. This special Impact documentary looks at the personal struggle of a child with a disability and how technology is helping him to exercise a basic human need, communication. In this story, we meet 2-year-old Maceo McKay, who was born with a rare condition that impairs his movement and speech. For Maceo, an iPad app helps him to communicate his needs in ways that may otherwise be impossible.
Here comes the sun, here comes the sun, it's all right.
I lift up my hospital gown because he's about to be born, and I'm fully expecting that the doctor's going to like take him out and he's going to come to my chest and we're going to live happily ever after.
My name is Maceo.
Hello, Maceo.
We were in the hospital and people are telling us, the regional center is a state program that does early intervention services for kids up to 3 years old who have cerebral palsy, mental retardation, Down syndrome, epilepsy, something like mental retardation. And we're like, services? What are services? It's like you're dropped onto this planet and then there's a bunch of people that are right there with you and then they start lifting off, like in an air balloon, and they're waving at you, bye, good luck, see you later. And you're like, what? Why are we here? What? It was absolutely, utterly confusing and devastating.
Oh my God.
That sound.
Yeah.
Good,
Ben?
Yeah. Da 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 da. Oh, that sound. That is the worst sound in the world.
Oops, sorry.
Words that come to mind are just so violent to describe the feeling of what it felt like to be in that NICU. It just felt like not a place where life was growing. It felt like a place where life was seeping away, you know?
You know, when I first met him, I didn't know what he had. We didn't have a cause for this. I think at the end of the day, we sort of did some tests and said, really, I think this is probably at this point hypoxic-ischemic encephalopathy. That's probably a variant on cerebral palsy. But when I first met him, we didn't know.
Oh, sorry.
Then my friends brought in another pediatrician to help us try to figure things out. And that guy said, look, anybody that tells you what Maceo is or is not going to do is full of it, because nobody knows. It's going to come down to what you three do. More than anything anybody tells you, anything that's ever happened before, just don't listen. It's up to you guys.
Okay.
And I don't know if you could hear that little squeak, how he's breathing. I don't know if it's a read on the recording, but like all the time, because he has this thing called laryngomalacia, which is his airway. It's floppy.
It's sort of the equivalent of snoring, but coming from a different part of the your respiratory system. So snoring happens because of the sort of floppiness in the palate in the back of the throat. So tracheomalacia, the floppiness is kind of down here in the trachea, but it's floppy, and so what happens, the air flows through it, it will sort of close off and open up again and close off and open again. You can hear that noise, and you may hear the whistling of the air through or a squeaking sound from that.
Run DMC or your basic green. Run DMC. All right, that's what you're looking at, so that's what I go for. Okay.
I think the biggest obstacle is the pain, where you're just like, why did it happen to him? You know, like, why did he have to get hurt? He's such a great guy. He's such a hard worker. He's such a nice guy. He's such a beautiful guy. Like, why did he get hurt, you know? But then, you know, the next thought that I have is, he's made me strong. And he's made my husband strong. And he's making my therapists and doctors smarter. So then I go, so much good has come from him getting hurt.
Are you feeling a little better with some food in your belly?
First, I asked my physical therapist, Susan, at Children's Hospital. I said, Susan, I feel like he's in there and he wants to communicate. Do you know any way that I can get in there? And she said, there's a woman in Pasadena, Cindy Cartier. Here's her number.
Maceo came for a consultation session, and we were looking at various kinds of technology for him. So we could say,
more. All done with that.
Again, Maceo for a young child, more like Maceo. He can maybe tell you if he wants to.
I want Barney.
Or he wants to see Elmo. Okay.
I want Elmo.
That would allow him to communicate better with his parents, with other people that maybe weren't so intuitive.
I want pizza.
There's approximately 30 to 40 what we call dedicated communication devices on the market. The most cutting edge device that we have on the market now is the iPad.
You know what day it is today?
Before this app and other apps on the iPhone and iPad, the only solutions that were there were really expensive. I mean, either it was cardboard and pencil, or it was a high-tech solution that could cost, for a mobile solution, anywhere from $2,000 to $3,000 to like $8,000.
They could do,
I want to go to the,
where are we gonna go?
Beach. I want to go to the beach.
In 1995, a friend of mine had a very serious car accident. He broke his neck, and afterwards he didn't really want to go through with life, and so I actually developed the on-screen keyboard for him. At some point he said, well, you know, I know some other people who could also make use of this.
Frustrated. No, obviously there's a lot more feelings under the sun than those. So I just added everything I could think of.
Understand, like laughing, a different feeling, better.
You know, there was one guy that came to help us with a mounting system for this. And he saw this feelings page that I had, this first one, and he said, well, you know, kids that are 2 years old, they don't really know about their feelings. So, I mean, we don't really do that. And I just thought, well, we've been talking to him pretty much since he came out of the womb. Hang on for 2 seconds, bud, I'm gonna get this food in you. Because our viewpoint is, if there's a glimmer of a chance that he's gonna know what's going on, we're not gonna bypass that by not talking to him or leaving him alone, or we're gonna err on the side of over-communicating so that he's constantly oriented with where he is and what's happening. And so because we don't talk to him like a baby, we talk to him like someone who understands what's going on.
I generally trust the parents a lot in this, because you have, there are sort of subtle clues about how children respond to you, about facial expressions, about what they seem to listen to, how well they seem to understand when you speak to them. Maceo seems to really pick up on things very quickly and has seemed to interact with his mother and with other adults very well, as well as with technology fairly well. So I think that speaks a lot to his level of comprehension.
Okay, time for exercises.
There are so many people that are familiar with this kind of technology. Even they either have an iPad or an iTouch or an iPhone or some type of technology already, that when people see individuals with disabilities using this, they can relate at a different level.
Are we going for the home button? It didn't take. There you go.
Something else. I feel. Happy.
Ah. I'm so glad you're happy.
For a child like Maceo, it gives him.
Oh, yeah.
The ability to indicate to people that he does have a brain, he does have thoughts, he has desires, and it's just not requesting things that he wants, but he's thinking about things, he's analyzing the world, he's taking in experiences.
Something else.
It's interesting to see how he kind of touches with his knuckles more than with the finger, and actually it seems to work quite well. The other thing that I find quite interesting to see is that he seems to be kind of planning where to touch, but then when he touches, doesn't actually look.
Something else about me.
That was a nice move. That was a very nice move.
My favorite book is the monster at the end of this book.
One of the things that I've seen frequently in children with movement problems is they also have movement problems with their eyes. And often their eyes and their hands are linked in very difficult ways. So one of the surprisingly common, and I don't understand why this happens, is that children who will reach for something can't turn the head toward the thing they're reaching at.
I had a birthday party.
Oh, yeah. How old are you? Right now.
I'm 2.5 years old.
With Proloquo to go from the basic design was that you should be able anywhere to add a new button that says something else, take a picture, and really customize everything on the fly. And what we really like is that many families are now making customizations themselves. And even children are often, you know, learning how to customize it, and that allows them to have a huge, you know, flexibility in their expression.
Love.
Love.
This is a really fun one. And he'll say,
I love you.
Like my dad is visiting. So we're all sitting around. He said, I love you. And then he's like,
Mom. Dad.
And Monica happened to be visiting. And he said,
Monica.
And then he goes,
my people. My family.
And this says Grandpa Nick. I didn't have a picture there because I didn't have a picture of them together because they'd never met before. So he goes like this. But it still said Grandpa Nick, and I had told him that that's what it said. He goes like this.
Nettie?
And it said Nettie, and I was like, I think he was going for Grandpa Nick. And then he goes,
Grandpa Nick.
Which was quite awesome because he never said that before.
You are very smart, aren't you? But this will stop you.
It gives us access to him and his personality and his thoughts and his ideas and his humor and his interests, things he doesn't like. It's really been, it's a lifeline in a sense, because all that he has to do is make contact with the screen. That's it. He just has to get a body part over to the surface of the screen. And by doing that, introduces a concept into the world. There was no way for him to do that before. No way.
What everyone wants to know is, how much does he understand of what's going on? And I can't read his mind to know. My sense is probably sometimes he doesn't care and he just hits the button and good, Mom smiled at me. And there's probably other times when he does care. He's surprisingly accurate. I mean, when you watch him do this stuff, he hits the buttons. So I can't say he wasn't doing that intentionally, because it's the right one.
Something else.
Good. Reaching out really nice.
My friend teaches me how to ride Linus.
Wow. Who's Linus?
My horse's name is Linus.
To get somebody his age using such a complex system, I think kind of floored all of us. We didn't really teach him to do that. He really did that on his own.
Oh, books, okay. What do you want to do?
The monster at the end of this book.
All right. He really understands the purpose of communication so well. He just needed to learn the tool, and that ended up, it just ended up being a really great tool for him.
Smart.
My biggest dream for Maceo is that Maceo could tell me his biggest dream. I think he's gonna be able to do it.
He has a very sophisticated taste in music, too. He's pretty, I've seen people try to sing like fun little kid songs with him, and some he likes, but he's usually like, no, I want to listen to the Beatles, or, you know. So I think it's just Maceo. Yeah, his personality.
I really like music.
That's so great.
I really like music.
Yeah!
I really like to move to the music.
It's really fun to move you to the music.
funniest thing is he really likes Lil Wayne.
You like that one, huh? He likes when I mess with his face.
I look at him and I see him smiling when the right song comes on, and I see him telling that he loves me, and I go, well, he's enjoying his life, like he really has a good time. And then the sadness kind of just like falls away. Give me five. Yeah, good job. Give me five again. Yeah.
The only thing I know for sure is he's going to keep getting better.
Okay, lift your leg up. I'm gonna put this one on.
That is certain. Because he's a kid and he's going to develop and he's going to learn things and he's trying to learn things. That's where the real hope comes from.
They're helping him, like you said.
Yeah. I think they give him enough stability down here that, you know, he can work everything else above it.
Guys, our physical therapist, do you think he's going to walk? She said, it's really hard to say.
Oh, you're going to go fast.
And she said, we'll probably be using some equipment for a few years.
I find it hard to imagine he would ever have a normal walking pattern, but not impossible.
Yeah, we're gonna bring the ball. We gotta bring it closer over here.
It's quite possible he'll be able to walk on his own. Walking requires a lot of different things. It requires the coordination, the strength, but it's learnable.
Hope you're pushing down. Okay, I'm gonna wait till you're gonna raise it up.
If the sport you're trying to learn is walking, and if the instrument you're trying to learn is, you know, how to move your arms or your body, it takes effort.
High five! High five! Can I have a high five?
A kid like Maceo, who clearly sits there and focuses and puts in the effort, I think has a great chance of learning this stuff and will continue to get better.
He is so persistent. He works so hard. How could he not? I mean, that's kind of my viewpoint. Like, how could he not? I just don't see any limit on anything that he can do.
And you were so scared.
It is pretty powerful when you have a child come in that has never been able to convey any of their thoughts in the past. And there are times when within a minute or two, giving them access to a communication device, you see the aha moment on that child's face where all of a sudden the world has been opened up to them. They see they have communication. They see themselves differently. They see the potential, and the look of joy of a child that has never been able to communicate and then all of a sudden within a few minutes be able to communicate, that's a pretty powerful moment.
I love you.
Aw, buddy. I love you so much. I love you so much. When he first said, I love you, it was quite amazing. And it was a kind of a thing where you're wondering, did he mean to do that? I think that he did, you know.
It's all right. Little darling, it's been a long, cold, lonely winter.
That's all for this edition of Impact. Be sure to check out all of our episodes at uscimpact.org. Now let's take a look at some of our upcoming stories.
The point of this is that we want people to be able to build their own home and not have to go and, you know, worry about taking out a mortgage from the bank, and it should be cost effective, that it should be accessible.
We're the last remaining PAC station in Southern California, and we are the only all-year-round PAC station in the United States. So it's extremely unique, and it would be a shame for it to die. You know, it's a blast to the past. It is a very cool thing.